of semaphores and there was some confusion. So I went back and did some more study. So let's start again with condition variables. Weight has these three important things. Assumes that the lock is held when weight is being called. This operation happens atomically. Fall into sleep, release the lock. When awoken, requires the lock before return. The opposite is a signal which makes a single waiting thread, and then there is no waiting thread, just returns. Okay, so they are, I've broken down how weight works into different pseudocode instructions. Assume that the lock is held initially, there is as such no requirement of a piece of code. So initially it calls unlock. Does that make sense? Why would you call unlock? Sorry?
Unlock is already.
Yeah, but why do we need to call unlock?
For this check to enter the critical.
No, so we're waiting.
If the number of sleep and if it remains locked, then it becomes.
So you remember that there are two things that we need to do. Put the call to sleep plus atomically release the lock. If you're putting to sleep, you have to release the lock so that some other thread can access the lock. And you want to sleep. So we don't want the processing to bother that. So there is a mutex unlock and there is a block on condition. Block on some condition variable CV. And after that you move from the ready to the waiting block state. So that is what it specifically means to be blocked or sleep. It just means that you have changed your state of the program. Eventually you move to the ready state and then you again call lock. So which of these are going to be atomic? So these six instructions, which two will execute together? Two and three, right? So the unlock happens with the blocking. And three is almost the same. The next one is almost the same, but let's for now keep it in. When does the signal come? Between which lines does the signal come?
Fourth
and fifth, right? So if the program or the thread has to move from the waiting on the block state to the ready state, there has to be signal. And once the signal has been received, so it moves to the ready state. But when does this wait function return? That's an important question. After? Okay. So what happens in between? If some other thread is acquiring the lock at that time, what happens? So at this point of time, this program is in the ready state. Let's say it gets to running sometime in between. But what happens? So does it immediately quit? No? Why does it not quit?
Not acquire the lock.
Because the lock is held by someone else. So until and unless some other thread releases the lock, you're going to be waiting in the wait itself.
So why did you not put the second point also as a part of the atomic instruction?
Okay, sorry. It was these two. So I wanted to put these two, second and third. I'll correct that.
So the entire wait is not atomic. I mean the first part and the like till blocked and till once it's ready to acquiring the lock.
No, so it's not atomic. So semaphores we discuss in the context of atomicity.
Hmm.
But since it has to wait, since it's given up the lock, so it can't be atomic in that sense. So we'll remember this for the next few slides that you can be, but you can, it's very possible that even after you've woken up, you'll have to be in some waiting state. Because you're waiting on the mutex.
So you consider the second and third point for atomic So without locking, how can you say that they are atomic? Without locking again. How can you say that they are atomic?
So that happens internally. So we don't necessarily have to do it here. So think of it as that it's done a hardware instruction, single hardware instruction. This is just some pseudocode which is given to easily understand that there are two different operations, but they should happen together. you return and the wait and the lock has been acquired. Okay. Why are we locking at this point in time? So we're just returning from the wait, right?
Because
why does it make sense?
Because
after wait, do we execute the critical section?
So because initially,
so when we go into wait, so we already have
the lock.
Right. So let's look at the solution. Okay, so let's look at the solution. At this point of time, the lock is being held by this thread join. Now, let's say that done equal to zero is true. So done is zero. So it goes into the waiting state. Conditional wait is being called. What happens then?
It goes to, it unlocks.
It unlocks and puts the thread to sleep. After that?
Okay.
After that, there will be a signal from the other thread. It will also increment done to one. And once the signal comes, it reacquires the lock and then it calls unlock. So if there is some unlock, there has to be corresponding lock. So that's one flow, that W, X, Y, Z. What happens if there is only W and Z? Is that possible? So we'll always have the locking and unlocking in pairs, right? So that is why we need to have the lock at this point. We also looked at, we started off with building a lock using semaphores. Sorry, we saw how can we build a lock using semaphores. The only thing we need to do is to initialize it with one, and before the critical section called wait, after the critical section called post. The definition of semaphore wait is we decrement the value wait if the value is negative, and for post we increment the value, that's it, and we wake up one thread in each wait.
So what is the second argument?
Zero. Zero is, so I think I told sometimes it is all the threads in the process share the semaphore. So I think there are variations to it in which you can use it across multiple processes also. I don't know how to do that, but that's possible. So we discussed one particular execution trace. The initial value in the semaphore, let's say, is 1. You started with 1. Now instead of 2 threads, I've now put 3 threads. So previously when we ran this example, I put 2 threads only. This is just to show that the value, the amount of negative value, the magnitude of negative value, is the number of waiting threads. So starts with 1, running ready, call sem wait, what happens then? It just increments and returns. Critical section begins, let's say at this point of time when interrupt happens, it is going to call sem wait. What is the value? 0. So what will sem wait do?
Wait.
It will decrement and then?
Wait.
It will wait. So does this notion now make sense? The critical section had begun, but the critical section had not ended. So if there is an interrupt in between, this thread would not be able to enter into the critical section because the semaphore was initially 0. Until unless the semaphore becomes 1, no thread would be able to enter into the critical section. Not necessarily 1, so we'll see that first. So the semaphore is now increment becomes -4, -1, less than 0, so it goes to sleep. Let's say now thread P2 is brought into the running state. Again, sem wait is called. What does the semaphore value become after that?
-2.
-2 is now indicating the number of waiting threads. So 2 indicates the number of waiting threads. So it also goes into the sleeping state. Now, maybe this should happen the next time, but sem post is being called for thread 0, so again the context switch happens. The critical section would have definitely ended, that is why sempost is going to be called. What does sempost do? Increments the value by 1 and
wakes up 0.
And wakes up 1 thread. So it increments the value becomes -1 and it is going to wake up another thread. So let's say it woke up thread 1. So at this point of time, the magnitude of the value of the semaphore is 1 and the number of waiting threads is also 1. So even though the value of the semaphore is negative, still we can have one thread, another thread executed. So it's the value which is mentioned is important at the beginning of the thread. So T1 is open and T1 is semaphore. supposed to come. Okay, so we, at this point of time, we have woken up T1. But why isn't T1 running at this point of time?
Why does it continue to be in the ready state only? Sorry?
It does not have the lock. In the sense that, while we have not as such discussed the implementation of semaphore post, but eventually it's going to be based on some condition variable only, right? Until and unless semaphore post returns, which means that it's given up the lock, this won't be able to accept the lock and then continue.
So I think this was one of the main points of contention which we had last time while discussing the implementation.
Okay, so we start with the implementation. We say that if it's just the initialization, we'll have a value condition variable and a lock. We define this as semaphore in this case. Initialization is failure triple. You initialize the value with value, you initialize the condition variable and the lock. And we saw that the post, sem post, is failure trivial to get. So there is a one-to-one mapping. Now, since value is being shared across how many threads? Any number of threads. So value has to be locked within a critical section, because its value, we have to ensure that it's modified by only a single thread at one point of time. So it goes in the mutex lock and unlock between them. We increment the value. And corresponding to wake on waiting thread, this is the condition set. So this was fairly trivial to understand. I think the only discussion which we had was in this one, send wait. So we discussed that instead of first decrementing the value and then waiting, we change the order a bit. We first check for the condition, and this was less than equal to zero. But we were discussing, so it seemed logical that this should be equal to zero, right? And not less than equal to zero, because this, the value of s never becomes negative. Does everyone remember this? I'll anyway walk through an example. So according to me, this should be equal to zero. But two textbooks are using less than equal to zero, so I don't know what's their rationale. But the textbook also does mention that this value never becomes negative. So if it never becomes negative, I think the condition should be equal to zero. So this was one point of contention. So let me, in fact, just run through this example to illustrate this concept better. So we also said that this does not maintain the invariance that the negative value of semaphore is telling us the number of waiting threads. So in this case, go back. Okay, minus 2 means the 2 waiting threads, right? So in the new semaphore implementation that we are coming up with, that invariance does not hold. The textbook said that it's because it's easier to implement, but I could not see any reason why direct one-to-one mapping would be complicated. Again, I have not figured out yet after spending some time, but maybe there is some reason. So let's say we, in this, our own semaphore implementation, we start with the value 1. Semaphore is initialized to 1. And we then call them wait. What does the value now becomes when you call them wait? What is ZenWait doing? It checks for the value. If it's less than equal to zero, or if it's equal to zero, then it sleeps using condition wait. Otherwise, it decrements the value and then unlocks. So if the value is 1, you call ZenWait, what happens? It gets out of the while loop. It decrements the value and just simply returns. The greater section will become begin. Let's say there's an interrupt at this point of time. You again call Zem wait in this thread. Zem is less than equal to 0, so you go to sleep. Right, it's equal to equal to 0. Let's say you switch to thread T2. Again call Zem wait less than equal to equal to 0, so you again you go to sleep. Now you switch to T1, critical section has ended. When you end the critical section, you call Zem post, not Zem post. And in this Zem post, so in the post, what you do, you acquire the lock. Then what you do? Increment the value. Increment the value of Zem, which now becomes 1. Then you wake up one of the threads. So waking up one of the threads is just a condition. You just call it condition signal. Let's say it ends up waking up thread T1. So now conditional wait will return only if it gets a lock. So it will be now locked, trying to get this mutex, this lock, which is currently being held by thread T0. And when it returns, it means that it's given up the lock. At that point of time, it can move from the ready to the running state. Does it make sense? Will then again decrement the value of them. So this is the other implementation which I found, which was saying that, which was a one-to-one mapping basically between a previous semaphore usage. So it just has a value field and it has a process list. It decrements the value by a 1, which is a one-to-one correspondence. You first decrement the value and the value is in 0, you add the process to the list and you block. So again, at a higher abstract level, this seems fairly easy, but I don't know why Linux ends up using something similar to the previous implementation. And if there are any hidden complexities in this, which can be difficult to implement using conditional variables. I don't know at this point of time. Okay, coming to concurrency bugs, we saw that atomicity, odd, and deadlock are few important types of bugs that we see. We saw one example of atomicity bug where let's say that this was defined in thread T1, but then thread T2 ran, this became null, and then again when the context is back, if you write f puts, so you're writing a null pointer, a null value, which is wrong. So you surround both these threads where these shared variables are being used using mutex locks and unlocks. We saw an example of auto violation that. So we cannot access the value before it's defined, so thread T1 has to run before T2. We can do this ordering either using semaphores or using conditional variables in mutex. We saw an example of a deadlock. If we run thread T1 in this order, that L1 runs, lock, L1 is acquired, L2 is acquired. After that point, both of them unlock and then L2 and L1 run. This is a perfect order. But if we have an order where L1 is acquired by thread T1, there is a context switch. L2 is acquired by thread T2. And then again, there is a context switch. So now L1 is going to wait for thread 2. And so L1 is going to wait for. So L1 wants to execute lock, wants to acquire lock L2, which is being held by thread 2. And thread 2 wants to acquire lock L1, which is held by thread T1. So it's a classic deadlock, which can also be represented in this fashion. So thread 1 is holding lock 1 at this point of time, but it's wanting lock 2. And similarly, thread 2 is holding lock 2, but it wants lock L1. So you can see a circular or cyclical dependency, which is an important or necessary condition for deadlock to occur. Okay, does anyone know why deadlock occurs in complex code bases? It's not a difficult answer, like I'm not expecting a technical answer. So obviously there is going to be human error, right?
Bad code.
So one interesting place where deadlock can occur is when you have encapsulated or you provided very So we provided a lot of abstraction to the users, but the underlying data structures or operations being used are multi-threaded. So for example, in this, so an example given is the Java vector add-all method. Let's say v1 is 145 and v2 two vectors are 678. If I call v1.add all v2, it becomes 145678. So that's what the method is going to do. So assume that add-all is multi-threaded. And it, now if it wants to run this operation, so it has to acquire a lock, right? Because it doesn't want any of these vectors to be modified in place, to be modified while it's running this operation. So let's say that add-all first puts a lock on v1, then puts a lock on v2, and then it unlocks in that fashion, in that order itself. Let's say that there is some other thread which ends up calling v2.add v1. So to the user, this seems fairly, fairly simple, nothing complicated, nothing dangerous at all. You add v1.addAllv2 and then v2.addAllv1. But then, since the underlying methods also are multi-threaded, this can create problems because now you can have the same situation as previously. Similar. So one of them locks L1, L2 and the other thread has the lock, them locking in a reverse order. So this can create a problem. The other is due to complex dependencies in the code. So the virtual memory system can call the file system. When does this happen? When do we need to put something into the file system? By file system, I mean the hard disk. Swapping, right? And when does the opposite happen? So one of them is swapping, one of them is swap out, right? So again, so A calls B and B calls A. So you can have that similar kind of situations where the dependencies, if not managed well, can create a deadlock. Okay, so now we're going to look at four necessary conditions for a deadlock to occur. The first one is fairly obvious, that the threads should be having exclusive control of resources. So if the threads do not have mutual exclusion, then will deadlock occur? So you have to have, you need to have mutual exclusion, right? Otherwise, this condition shouldn't happen. Hold and wait. So where do we see this condition in the previous examples? So one of the threads was holding L1, it was waiting for L2. The other one was holding L2, it was waiting for L1. The third condition, no preemption, that resources cannot be removed. So for example, if thread T1 has taken a block L1, until and unless it completes its critical section, it won't be giving up that block. Similarly, the other one. So you cannot preempt these processes. And the fourth one, circular wait. So there is a circular chain of threads, such that each thread is holding one or more resources requested by the next thread. So can anyone figure out the difference between hold and wait and circular wait?
Circular wait is like timing philosophers.
Mm-hmm.
One is waiting for that and then chain is waiting.
Okay, good. So let's solve one of these. Let's solve these problems one at a time. Let's try and solve circular wait. The deadlock version of this program is the following. Can you change something in this code? Can you make it some trivial changes so that circular dependencies don't happen?
Swap the log.
The order of which one?
Any
of them. Yeah, so that's called total ordering. So the order in which they're acquired in one particular thread should be the same order of lock acquisition in the other threads. So if that happens, then this problem won't happen. So let's say that now thread T1 acquired L1. Thread T2 cannot acquire L1 because thread T1 has not completed. Until and unless thread T1 now in fact completes all these locking and unlocking, thread T2 won't be able to start with the execution. Okay, so here's a question for you. So define a function this will do something which works correctly even if the two threads are called as, so T1 calls this function do something L1 comma L2 and T2 calls do something L2 comma L1. And this is the definition, this is the prototype of the function. Lock 1 and lock 2. So irrespective of which way you give the arguments, the correct total ordering will be ensured.
Sort of according to pointer value?
Sorry?
Are you getting a pointer value? So sort of according to pointer value.
So ignore the syntax thing for now. Just assume that you're getting lock 1 and lock 2. The two threads are going to call this function differently, but we still want to ensure that there is no deadlock.
If I do something, it means whenever the lock is called, it calls do something internally.
No. So thread T1 will call do something. It's a function. It calls L1 and L2, and the other thread will call do something L2 and L1. So this is maybe an error on the part of the human being, but we still want to ensure do something is made in a way that irrespective of which order you pass into the arguments, you'll still get the correct ordering between the threads. So in still, irrespective of what happens, in both the threads, L1 will execute first and then L2 will be acquired, or the vice versa.
So can we like maintain an ordering of all locks separately and then we'll check in that?
Global ordering of the locks.
That's broadly what you need to do, but I'm asking for a simple function between L1 and L2. So some property of L1 and L2 you need to use so that you can write this, complete this function. Okay, what is the address of L1? Is there any relationship between address of L1 and L2?
One
will be lesser than the other, right? They won't be equal. So can you use that property to...
It's just a pointer address. That time.
Yeah. So you just see if M1 is greater than M2 or M2 is greater than M1. So if M1 greater than M2, let's say you call M1 M2. Otherwise, you call M2 M1. So it doesn't matter which, so if you call M2 M1 here and M1 M2 here. But you just need to ensure that you check the condition. And assume that they don't get the same address, which won't happen if they're the different blocks. Does everyone get this?
So, we can only swap the two blocks only in this case. Mm-hmm. In like the general case, if you have any possibility that you might not be able to swap the.
Can we then sort them?
There are two different functions which are using the lock. Probably there might be some case where if we change the ordering, then we might lead to some lock.
So that's possible that what we do somewhere can affect somewhere in the code. So in general, there's a difference between partial ordering and total ordering. What you want to ensure is total ordering in general. So that's a global level thread lock ordering. But what we are doing here in some sense is just local partial order. So it can still create problems. This is not a perfect solution.
Suppose if there is a case where one thread calls log 1 and log 2, and the other calls log 2 and log 3, and the ordering is according to
the so they are not calling the exact same set of logs.
So
the one log is wrong. So the first thread is great for log 2, but the second.
Okay, so that particular situation, I'll come to it.
That is not a deadlock.
That's not a deadlock. That's not a deadlock.
Right, so the deadlock will only occur if all of these conditions hold true. So maybe only one of the conditions is holding true.
Okay.
So let's say we want to ensure that hold and wait doesn't create a problem. So this was the deadlock version. So how can you ensure that you're not holding and waiting for one resource?
So keep a timer if it's not using, if it doesn't go to the next statement, make it give up the lock.
that's going to be in the preemption case. Okay. Or give up the lock. You don't give up the lock in this case. But what you want to ensure is that you're not holding and waiting. Which means that only one of these threads can hold all the resources. How do you ensure that?
You can test if the blocking being
handled. Okay, so that's again in the right direction, but not the perfect answer. So we want only one thread to be able to execute these locks together. So think of them as adding a layer of higher level lock.
So you basically lock the locks?
So we acquire all the locks atomically. So if you do that, you won't have any. You won't have a situation where you have held one lock and you're waiting for another. So what you want to do is to convert this into lock all and then unlock all. So which means that once you've acquired this mega lock, now you won't be holding and waiting for this. If you hold this, you'll also be able to hold this without any problems. Does it make sense?
In this case, do we need lock L1 and
L2? Let's say that internally is required for some function.
So what if there are some instructions in between calling lock L1
and L2? But it's still not as such waiting, right? So waiting means that it's waiting for some other thread to give it to. So it's just a sequential run. Okay, what are the negatives of such an approach?
So only one can hold all the locks.
So you lose the concurrency. And of course, you also need to know ahead of time which all locks will be required. Otherwise, you don't know at what point lock and create unlock.
So how do we lose concurrency?
Sorry?
So how do we lose the concurrency?
So at one point of time, only one particular, so not completely lose concurrency, but it will be now reduced by in certain order. Because you have now, you can only reduce, so earlier you could have run this line, and then you can run the others, but now you need to execute all of this part together. So the critical section in some sense increases in size. Okay, so no preemption. Don't look at this. So let's say that there is a possibility of preemption. So how will you solve that? Like, use preemption in one of these to ensure that, you know, you're able to acquire all the locks.
If I had acquired one lock and I'm waiting for the other one, then I'll
just give it. So it's a simple function. Let's say you acquired lock L1. Now you'll try and acquire lock L2. So if you're not able to acquire lock L2, you also give up lock L1. Does that make sense? Everyone with me? But does this have any problem? So this approach have a problem?
Let's suppose the same, both the threads are doing the same.
Okay, so what's the solution? So does everyone understand the problem? Or can you speak it out louder and explain?
So if the same code is running for both the threads simultaneously for thread 1 and thread 2.
Mm-hmm.
So initially thread 1 will acquire lock 1. And thread 2 will acquire lock 2. So thread 1 will call this function try lock L2, which is held, it will unlock L1. Similarly, thread 1 simultaneously also does the same thing. It heads lock L2, but won't be able to get lock L1, so it gives us lock L2.
So that particular problem is called live lock. So now you have a live contention between these blocks. And how can you solve that?
Lock it.
Sorry. No, so there is a simpler solution than that. And that particular solution is also being used in networking, computer networking. So whenever you have multiple people want to send the signal on the same channel, let's say that each time they try to send, there is some contention that the channel is occupied. So what do you think, how can you solve that? No, so there's no notion of a queue because they're both going to work independently. So there is no synchronization between them as such. So other way to think of it could be, let's say there are two people who want to, you know, cross one door. And initially, both of them are at the same location on the ground, same in one axis.
So if they keep on walking in that, so they'll have a collision. That's not going to work. Now what this is doing is that both the people are acting very robotically. So there is a very simple determinism to the program. So both the programs will say, let's say, let me try and move right by one step, and then let me try and cross. Could you change this slightly to ensure that both the people can cross? And let's say the program is every 100 milliseconds, I turn right by, sorry, I move my feet right by one step, and then I try to cross. So the determinism is crossing problem. If you remove the determinism, could you walk through?
We can add a random.
That's the simple answer. So use random wherever you find such contentions. Even in computer networking, you'll see when you have multiple contention. So one of them, so both of them now are random delay between reaching. So that will probabilistically work most of the times. Adding random beta. Okay, mutual exclusion. So mutual exclusion, any idea how we can solve avoiding holding a lock? So why did we end up requiring a lock in the first place?
Run the critical section.
Sorry?
To run the critical section.
Yeah, so what if the critical section was not a critical section? Would we still have required a lock? So what makes a critical section a critical section? Shared variables is fine, but if X plus plus was atomic, would it still be if X is shared, but if X plus plus is atomic, do we still require mutual exclusion?
No.
No, right? So the absence of atomicity in some sense requires us to use mutual exclusion. Mm. So if we can somehow make everything atomic, can we avoid deadlocks? Yes, because we can avoid the need of mutual exclusion. So the idea is to use atomic instruction, and I'm going to show a slightly different variation of compare and swap. So previously when we saw compare and swap, I think we were returning new here, right? Were we returning new or old? Old, right? Okay, so let's forget about that for a minute. I just look at the simple definition. So int address expected a new. If the address is expected, you change the value, return 1, otherwise you return 0. Okay, so can you use this code to implement x equal to x plus k atomically? Think for a minute and write in your notebooks. The first entry is that there has to be a while somewhere. Second end is that it has to be a do while. So that's at least one of the implementations. So what do you expect? Address expected a new values. What should be expected? So one of them has to be x, one of them has to be x plus k, right?
The new Indian expression.
Does this solution make sense to you? So let's say that we want to ensure that this is atomic, which means that no other thread can change the value of old between this operation.
Okay.
So old equal to value, let's say that the value was initially x equal to 10. Okay, so old becomes 10. Now you do while compare and swap value is okay, so value can now be modified by some other thread. Does that make sense? So that is why we got the value initially. What was the value of value when you started off with executing this function? So it was in this particular thread, let's say it was 10. Some other thread, let's say, modified it to 15. Right? So value is 15, old is 10. So we go back to the compare and swap. Address equal to expected. Is address equal to expected? No, right? So it returns 0. This whole thing is now true. While condition is true, which means that you go back to the start of this do while loop. You again get the value. Let's say the value was already incremented by 15, right? So you pick up the value, newer value, which is 15. Now is 15 equal to 15? Yes. If 15 is equal to 15, then you put value is equal to value plus amount. Let's say amount was 5. So it becomes 15 plus 5, 20. And you return 1. And once you return 1, you come out of the while loop. This is clear? So even if it's not, we just do work it out a couple of times with these different values, then you'll be able to figure it out. You can also similarly do list insertion using atomic instructions. The race condition happens in these two lines. I'm just directly showing you the answer. It's fairly similar to the previous one. You acquire the head and you compare and swap with head and end.next. So if you follow the previous one and if you look through this one, you should be able to figure out the solution. Still, I'll use 20 more seconds. So you can also avoid deadlocks using scheduling. Let me cover this tomorrow. Next. Mark will do it anyway later.